Welcome to TheatreCast. You reached episode number 84, being recorded April 10th, 2016. This is a show where theater teachers and professionals share their passion for theater trends, share practical advice and tips, and ask questions of some of theater's most innovative collaborators. I'm one of your co-hosts, Nick Cusumano, and joining me this week, I'm very excited, is Donna Lynne Champlin. And I love the internet because it can bring people together. I discovered Donna Lynne watching the show on the CW, and I'm sad to say I didn't start when it first aired, but during Christmas time, to escape from family, I watched The Crazy Ex-Girlfriend. I was like, oh, I've seen this one. Because usually when I'm at school and I have to stay after, and it's like 2 hours before like open house or whatever, I'll go to like Broadway.com or Broadway World just to see what's happening in New York. And they love My Crazy Ex-Girlfriend. And so I found Donna Lynne on there and been a fan and watching the show voraciously. I think it is so smart and so witty and so... I think it does what entertainment and theater and... what the arts do best is it's a mirror that reflects life, but in a heightened way. And I think probably most of us have been through some unrequited love, at least in high school, and probably after high school too. But, you know, that's when you feel it most. And the story follows character Rebecca, played by Rachel Bloom, who has a crush on her high school boyfriend from theater camp, and sees him in New York and decides to move from New York to all the way to West Covina, California, which is our actual place. And I think in my research I found you all received the key from the city. Am I right in that?
Yes. Did. That was thrilling. It really was.
Yeah, how often do you get the key to the city? It doesn't happen too often. That's
it was crazy.
And Donna Lynne plays Paula, who works at the law firm White Feather and Associates. She's Paula Proctor, the paralegal. I love the alliteration. And can you kind of tell us what the dynamic is between you and the character Rebecca on the show?
Sure. You know, I'm in West Covina. I'm working at like a low level law firm, White Feather. I'm the head paralegal. And Rebecca Bunch comes in. She's this beautiful, young, accomplished Harvard grad who's for some reason transferring from a very high-powered, high-paying job in New York. And so in the pilot, a good deal of the pilot, I'm very suspicious because none of it makes sense to me. I can't quite figure out why she's here. And she's saying she wants a change, but that doesn't sit right with Paula. So she does some slight espionage, breaks into her computer, maybe, and figures it out that she's here for Josh Chan. And so by the end of the pilot, you think, I mean, what I love about it is it was set up as like, oh, she's going to be, you know, like the nosy neighbor from across the street, you know, she's going to be that character. Mrs. Kravitz, and then by the end of the pilot, they did a hairpin turn, and it turns out that Paula is like this crazy romantic, and also very unsatisfied in her own life, and looking for an escape, and, you know, she's also kind of surrounded with a bunch of people who don't get her. I think she's incredibly smart. I think, she's very funny, she's very real. And she's also damaged. I mean, the thing about our show is, yes, you know, Rachel plays the crazy ex-girlfriend, but in reality, every character on this show has some sort of emotional issue. And So with mine, it comes out as codependency, because we just sort of latch onto each other on this goal of getting her with Josh Chan, because I'm like, you know, you're not crazy, you're in love. And that's a completely different thing. That is a noble cause, and I am going to help you. So what's really great is that as the first season kind of expanded, you started to see the chinks in everybody's armor. Mm-hmm. And so it explores the idea of craziness, but not just in our lead character. It explores how everybody's crazy tries to intermix with everybody else's crazy, and what happens when one of the crazies gets better. You know, mm-hmm. that's kind of what's happening right now. We're two episodes away from ending season one. Rachel, Rebecca, the character Rebecca, is actually starting to get better. And that is throwing Paula into a complete tailspin.
Mm-hmm. Last episode.
Right.
It's so wonderful how you all are able to balance that. You can play, and I don't think I said in the beginning, there's also songs during the show. It's a musical, too. But they're able, and I think what's really exciting about it is you get that inner monologue of those characters so that we really see what's going inside their head in a very entertaining and pop culture way. And making fun of our pop culture and just tying into it, but also, you know, what these characters are going after and trying to find in their lives. And I have not seen the last two, and I'm going to try to be good in that.
It's tomorrow.
Yeah, tomorrow.
And then a week from now is our finale, yeah.
And I want to know what happens, but I'm going to try to be good.
The struggle is real.
But I know, Paula had that real, she's like, well, if, you know, Rebecca was letting go of Josh a little bit and trying to be good and noble and just let's just see what life brings, and Paula just threw a little, through her magical technical powers, threw a little wrench in that.
I think Paula missed her calling as, like, FBI or CIA for sure.
Yeah, I think she would unlock that phone for the FBI in no time.
They're in a barrier, so Paula is concerned. Yeah, she's like, she's super smart. Way more tech-savvy than I am. So, you know. Which is hilarious, too, because, you know, they're constantly giving me, props, they're giving me iPhones, they're giving me computer screens, and like I am the worst with the technical, you know, computer stuff. And so every time I sit down to a scene and they go, okay, so you press this button and that happens and this button, blah, 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 and I'm like, I just want to save my life. every time.
Yeah, I guess that would be another interesting, you know, sometimes when you're acting in their stage business, but like you're typing in words and getting lines out and trying.
The difference between theater and television, which has taken me a long time to get used to, is that, you know, in theater, you have 4 weeks. You have your props, like, hopefully by day one. So by the time you're, you know, in front of an audience, you've managed to, you know, get your flow and know exactly when you're going to put the phone down and put it up. They literally give you the prompts like 10 minutes before you shoot.
Oh, goodness.
And not only do they give you the props at the very last second, and that's not anybody's fault, it's just how it is, you know, it's everyone's moving as fast as they can. Then, for continuity, which again, theater, you know, this does not apply, you have to figure out, you know, when you're gonna, you know, have the phone, and then you're going to put it down on this line. And then you have to do that every single time. So you have to make your decisions incredibly fast, and then you have to live there. And that for me as a theater performer has been one of the most difficult adjustments.
Yeah, I guess so, because, you know, as, you know, as you were saying, as theater actors, you have that wiggle room when you're on stage.
Weeks of wiggle room.
You know, once it shows up, oh, if I want to try, you know, say it slightly different here and see what happens and in the moment. Yeah. But
well, this phone doesn't work for me, or can we find some, you know, there's like mm-hmm. a process to it. And then, like, you know, you get on set and, like, I have this phone, this polyphone, and I take full responsibility for it. I mean, the props department in our show is amazing. I had some, like, all I would do is I would literally, like, shake it like this, like if I was gesturing, and it would, like, call Japan. And the props department was baffled because it just never did that when anybody else did it. So I had to just learn not to even gesture with it. So, I mean, oh, Lord, you know, it's a very, very, very different technical process between theater and on camera.
And just to touch on, so I found, of course, found out who you were on My Crazy Ex-Girlfriend, but then I went to your website, and boy...
I apologize, it's a hot mess right now. Again, technically, you know, not that.
No, just all that you've done, you are a very accomplished theater actress. And have been able to work with so many different people that I think growing up and or just, you know, you've been lucky enough to work with people like Hal Prince and Stephen Sondheim and Carol Burnett and Rita Moreno, and I'm sure there's even tons more than I...
It's ridiculous.
You know, to one, to make it as a working actress, and two, to be able to, you know, not only just pay your bills, but to work with these theater artists that and performers. We'll transition a little bit into theater for the moment, and then we'll kind of go back, and I can't, because the show's called TheatreCast, so we'll take a little bit of time to talk about theater.
Let's talk about the Broadway.
I've always had a connection, or at least watching, read all her books, May do Hollywood Arms, and that was your Broadway debut?
No, actually,
that was The Dead.
Broadway debut was James Joyce's The Dead, and then I did By Jeeves, which was,
that's right.
Had a score by Andrew Lloyd Webber, and was directed and written by Alan Ayckbourn. And then... I did Hollywood Arms because I had done another show that was a regional show that Hal Prince had directed, and the part that I played in that made him think I was had kind of like a Carol Burnett kind of vibe, and so when we played, it was called Three. It was the number three, and then H-R-E-E. And we did it at the Prince Theater in Philly, and then we did it, I believe, at the Amundsen in L.A. And when we were in L.A., he said to me, very offhandedly, so I've been working on this play with Carol Burnett, and I don't know, I think you'd be real good in it. I think you'd be a good Carol Burnett. Is that something you're interested in? And I was like... I'm sorry, what did you just say? Would I be interested in it? Let me think about it. Yes. So when we did the show in L.A., Carol came to see it, to see my work and to check me out, and, you know. And then I met her afterwards, and it was like, I mean, just vowels came out of my mouth, like no consonants at all. Like, I was so happy she saw, and of course, like, the show she came to, like, everything went wrong. Right? That's what always happens when you do a show, mm-hmm. where your parents come, or your agents come, or your partner comes. It's always, like, the worst show you've had, like, the whole run. So we had that show, of course. Everything broke, everything fell, everything, you know? But she was so sweet, she came back to my dressing room, and I was like, you know? And she was like, oh, honey, nice to meet you, too. I was like, and that's it. There goes that job. And then there was nothing. Hal didn't say anything about it for months and months and months. And then all of a sudden he calls me up and he says, we're going to do the Carol Burnett play in Chicago. So he was like, now, you know, you got to audition. You got to, you know, and I was like, well, of course I have to. I'm not going to expect you to, like, hand me this amazing role. Like, I got to work for it. And so I did. So I auditioned for it and I ended up getting cast. And then we went to the Goodman in Chicago and then we came into town and we went to the court.
And
I know, bananas.
I think she's inspired so many people. Both of us are the same age. We won't say that on camera. That's what we want to. I want you to take
29.
Yeah, 29. And I just remember, you know, watching the reruns of the Carol Burnett Show growing up, you know, video camming, doing the Gone with the Wind sketch, or doing, and just,
you know, God bless her. She gave Bob Mackie all the credit for that. She said that she tells the story a lot where, you know, they had the script, and they worked very fast, too. You know, they only had a week to, like, do, and they had musical numbers. I mean, they were, like, you know, tip to tail. That was a lot of stuff to do. And, you know, Bob Mackie did the costumes. And so she went for a costume fitting. And she said, you know, what are you thinking for this Gone with the Wind sketch? And he was like, well, I have an idea. You know, I feel free to say no. And he had done a mock-up and he brings it out. And she fell on the floor laughing. She was like, this is hilarious. So this is what we're doing. But that's the thing about Carol is she's just so incredibly generous and selfless and so kind. Mm-hmm. You know, that's really the thing. You know, she's just such an incredibly kind person. And I think that's part of her, you know, appeal. Is mm-hmm. you can feel that. You know, it's not an act. It's not like, you know, she really is that sort of so warm and generous and kind. And, you know, I mean, point in fact, like Rachel and our showrunner, Aline Brosh and mm-hmm. McKenna, they were both huge fans of Carol Burnett. And I don't think they even knew that I had worked with her, let alone played her in a play that she wrote. Like, I don't think they even knew when they hired me. And it came up in conversation somehow, and they looked at me and they were like, you know Carol Burnett? And I said, well, yeah, I know her very well, you know, and they were like, I said, well, you know, let me see if she's even out here. You know, a lot of times she's traveling, she's doing book tours, she's in New York, she's doing Broadway shows. Like, you know, let me just shoot her an email, see if she's around. And literally I went home, I was going to send an email and I had an email from Carol.
Oh, wow.
And she had seen the show and she loved the show. And she said it reminded her of her show, you know, trying to fit it, get those musical numbers done and get them all done and get it done in a week. And she loved Rachel. And I was like, okay, so this is clearly kismet, because I was literally going to email you. And I said, here's Rachel's email and her phone number. I'm more than happy to pass your sentiments on, but you would make her life if you wrote to her or called her personally. If you don't want to do it, that's fine. But, like, I mean, it would blow her mind. And she did. And then they had an email relationship. And then, like, Rachel won the Golden Globe. And Carol sent her this email. You know what I mean? And so we actually finally all had a chance to have lunch.
Awesome.
Which was just, you know, so great. And, you know, at this point it was great because she and Rachel had, like, this email relationship. And it was just four funny ladies at a table. In you know, Montecito. It was awesome. But again, that's Carol, though. You know, she's like, well, of course I'll have lunch. Of course we'll have lunch, you know? And I just kind of want to go, you know you're Carol Burnett, right? You remember that, right? Like, you could totally say no.
But I was...
She's a brilliant woman.
I was, I think it was driving her, just thinking about doing our interview and the Carol Burnett connection, and I think an interesting thing that was in the Carol Burnett show that's also in My Crazy Ex-Girlfriend is, like, if you think the family sketch, how serious, I mean, they dealt with some very serious issues in a very funny way, but yes, also heart-wrenching, too.
Oh, I know. And I brought that up, actually, at our lunch. We talked about that, you know, a lot, and riding that line of very serious issues, but still, you know, making it funny, but not making the topic the expense of the joke. It's a very, very delicate way of writing, and it's funny. She actually brought that up and was like, you know, I haven't seen that in a long time, and I haven't, you know, I know we used to deal with that and with the Mama's Family sketches. But yeah, no, definitely.
Wow, that's just been so lucky to work with so many great people. So you got, I was reading in one of your interviews about James Joyce, the dead, and stepping into, or your first time out there, or,
and that was, well, here's what happened. Okay.
And that just shows the power of theater, too.
And also the lesson that, like, when the gig is yours, it will come to you. Come hell or high water. And if the gig is not yours, it will pass you by, no matter how hard you try to manipulate it. And that has taken me so long to learn. But it's such an easier way to live as an actor when you finally realize that your gigs are going to come to you regardless of what hurdles they have to jump to get to you. You just have to make sure you're ready for it when it comes. That's your job. Your job as an actor is to make sure that you are trained and ready and in a position to seize that opportunity when it comes. Your job is not really to manipulate the universe to make us, you know what I mean? If I had my way, if I could have planned my own career, it would have been so less awesome than what it ended up being. You know, because my thinking was very narrow. What did I think I would cross-dress as an accordion piano flute-playing man in Sweeney Todd on Broadway? No! Who thinks of that? Not me. Do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So it's just sort of like, you know, so the debut was kind of the same thing. I went to school with Emily Skinner. We both went to Carnegie Mellon. We were very, very close friends. She's one of my best friends. And she had done The Dead at Playwrights off-Broadway. And it was such a hit that they were transferring. But because they were transferring with the cast intact, they had minimal rehearsal time. Because they didn't need to rehearse all those people. They had just rehearsed and done a run at Playwrights. But at Playwrights, they had no understudies. So they move the production, and all they have to do is add understudies. But the problem is, when they moved it to the Belasco, their rehearsal process was 1 week of tech. And then previews. So I could not get seen for that show. My agents pushed, everybody pushed. I could not get in because, ironically, even though it was an Irish show, which obviously I am, I was hired to, I mean, the job was to cover Alice and Emily, who both, you know, look like they just stepped off of a Swedish airplane. You know what I mean? Like, the point was to cover them, whether they looked Irish or not. So, and they had just done sideshows, so there was, like, you know, understudies coming out of their ass. So it was really hard to get in. Anyway, Emily, being amazing, she was like, this is ridiculous. I'm going to the director. I'm telling him he has to see you. And the only thing I ask is that when he gives you the job, I get to call you. And I was like, that's amazing. No pressure. Let's do it. And she did. She went up to the director, and she was, and we had been trying so hard and for so long to get me in that literally the auditions were the next day. So she, and I was in an off-Broadway show myself, so I couldn't come see her. So I hadn't seen the show, I hadn't seen the script, I didn't know anything. She got me an appointment the next day. After their show that night, both Alice and Emily got on the phone with me and walked me through their material. I went in the next afternoon, I did my audition, and it was like 20 people behind the table and like no reactions. You know those rooms? Where they're all just sitting there and they're like, 20 people, and I was like, and I'm out. So I called Emily afterwards. I was like, you're the best friend ever. This is not going to go my way. I got no juice in the room. It was completely dead. I felt really good about what I did, but, I'm sorry if I made you look bad. 2 hours later, she calls me. This is before cell phones. This is how old I am. She calls the box office of my theater on Broadway, leaves a message, and I still have it. I have it framed. I should show you. Where did it go? There's a post-it that says, from Emily Skinner, you got the job. I have some. I don't know where it. Damn it. I don't know where it is. But I have it framed somewhere. And so that's how I got the job. Now, I go to rehearsal, which is tech. And they're not thinking about us, because it's tech. They have to think about
the cues and changing for a whole theater.
We have no scripts. We have no scores. Because the process of doing it at Playwrights was so kind of organic that the stage management wasn't able to keep up, I guess. So there was no script or no score. But anyway, I'm thinking, I'm at rehearsal every day. And I had actually taken notes. For two roles, for both Alice and Emily. Anyway, second preview. I haven't set foot on the stage. I have never even set, I have no costumes. They call me, and they say, Emily's down. Emily's out. And they were like, look, we understand. You've had no rehearsal. You haven't set, you have no costumes. You've no score. Nothing. And of course, I was like, are you kidding? This is my job. Of course I will go on. And then I vomited into a waste paper basket. So I get there like literally 90 minutes before curtain. Now, here's the amazing thing, though, about that particular production was it was very Chekhovian. So there was, and it was a party. It's a Christmas Eve party. So there's backs to the audience. It's very organic. It looks like you're sort of eavesdropping.
Mm-hmm.
It's very non-presentational. And so, and I, of course, am one of the three women hosting this party. So I had to be like, the ography of just the dinner alone. Pour the lemonade on this, pick up that plate on that line, move this around. It was mind-boggling. And this cast was so, I'm totally going to tear up. This cast was so generous. And I'm talking Blair Brown, Alice Ripley, Christopher Walken, Sally Ann Howes, Marnie Nixon, Daisy Egan, like I'm talking, Patti Nixon, I'm talking about huge, huge stars, all of them, Steven Spinella, and they were so good to me that literally the whole show was, my character was Mary Jane, and they were like, Mary Jane, why don't you sing sing that Irish song that, you don't know it, let me sing it with you. Or, Mary Jane, can you take my glass now, please? And can you move that plate over there while I do this? Oh, great, wonderful. And they would take me by the arm, and they would move me around, and they fed me all night. Now, I had a grasp on what my job was. I knew the gist of my lines. It's not like I was, just a mannequin being moved around by people. I had watched a week of tech, but I didn't, know the lines. So I got the gists out, and if there was a technical thing that needed to be said that I missed, somebody would spot me. Alice or Blair would be like, oh, do you mean the blah, 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 blah? Is that what you're talking about? And I'd be like, why, yes, it is. Why don't you tell the story? And I swear to God, there was one moment in the show where I finally got to sit down as the hostess. I finally got to sit, and the rest of the company raises a glass and toasts us, the three Graces, the three hosts. And it was the first time since I got the phone call that I sat for a second. And I just remember looking out and seeing the audience and seeing these amazing people. And we were about three quarters of the way through the show, and I just began to sob. I couldn't help it. It was the stress and it was the moment. And I'll never forget it. Blair Brown raises her glass. And she winks, she winks at me and she goes, to you. And what could have been the most nightmarish Broadway debut, in the history of the planet, to me, is one of the most beautiful moments I've ever had in my life, like let alone the business. And it was just, I just could not believe the generosity of all of these people, these major players, helping me out. And then on the curtain call, I didn't even know they were going to do this. We're all bowing, right? You know, I'm taking my cue off everybody. We bow now. Okay, we bow. I bow. They all backed up while I was bowing and stood up. So I was the only one bowing. Tricky. Tricky bastards. They gave me a solo bow without my even realizing what was happening. I mean, come on.
I mean, that...
It's unbelievable,
and,
right?
And when you talk, you know, in theater, we talk so much about the ensemble, and I'm always trying to work on that and with my students, but just, wow, that is just, I mean, that's the true definition of ensemble is...
Yeah, and even when we did Sweeney Todd, you know, we had Patti LuPone, we had Michael Cerveris, obviously huge, huge, huge players, and Patti LuPone, man, John Doyle, you know, because she played Lovett before, like we don't, like everyone plays, you know what I mean? Like you play Lovett, like Angela Lansbury kind of set the footprint or the blueprint, and everyone kind of stays in that, you know, Waka Waka place, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's how it's done. And John Doyle, our director, clearly was going for something else. In fact, in rehearsal, he would constantly say, does it feel less like Sweeney Todd yet? Let me know when it doesn't feel like Sweeney Todd at all, and then where I want you to be. And so with Patti, he kept stripping her of stuff. You know, he stripped her of, you know, her props, and then he stripped her of the accent, and then he stripped her of the music, until she was finally just standing there just saying the words. And I'll never forget it. She turned around to us, and she had tears in her eyes, and she said, it is so wonderful to be treated like an actress again. You know? And we were all like, we got you. We are here for you, whatever you need to do. And so she was allowed by John to start from the ground up on a very iconic character. And she truly made this unbelievably different, alive, authentic Lovett that no one had ever seen. And for me to sort of watch Patti LuPone, you know, do that work, do as part of an ensemble, was astonishing to me. I would run into traffic for Patti LuPone. I think she's amazing. And one of the best parts of my job was to watch her work every night, because she was never inauthentic and she was never the same, but she was always within her parameters,
mm-hmm.
of whatever rules, you know, John had said or we had all agreed upon. And that for me was one of the best parts of my job was watching Patti LuPone work eight shows a week, and knowing that performance had come from such a pure place. I mean, imagine being Patti LuPone for a second. You know, the pressure that's on you when you're starring in a new musical, half of that audience wants to come and see you be Patti LuPone, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And half of the audience wants to come and see Mrs. Lovett. So, you know, I can only imagine when you're at that iconic status that you walk into every job thinking, I'm going to disappoint 50% of the people who show up. Do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
That's got to be such a difficult place to live. And because John allowed her to create such an authentic thing and treat her like an actress from Juilliard, which is what she is, well, no one walked out of that theater disappointed.
And some of the interviews I've seen, or I think I might have watched her do it's a competition where the kids send in and they narrow it down to like 8 kids and master art classes, and
oh,
she did on that.
And,
I'll send you the link after the show, but
okay.
It's really interesting, and here and there that where I've caught. She is to me the definition of professionalism as a theater artist. I mean, yeah. She is ready to do the work, and she expects everyone else to do the work. And she expects the audience to do their work, too.
Here's the thing. She treats the show because, like church.
Yeah.
She would constantly make that analogy, especially if she saw that red light in the audience and she knew somebody was videotaping, or if she saw the glow of like a phone, if somebody was clearly like texting or whatever, she would become so offended, not because they weren't watching her work, you know, it wasn't about that, it was because the theater to her is like church.
Mm-hmm.
And she constantly made that analogy. She was like, she felt it was blasphemous. It wasn't insulting to her from her ego, it was blasphemous to what the theater is. You know, that's where she comes from. She's an astonishing woman. You know, the fact that I had the privilege to work with her is, I still kind of can't believe it. She's amazing. Yeah.
And can we talk a little bit more about that production? Because I think it is definitely,
sure.
The approach to it.
Where do I start? Start with the first day of rehearsal when I asked John Doyle to fire me?
Sure, let's start there.
Okay. Well, first of all, a quick story about how I got that role, which is kind of funny. Because I went in for the beggar woman, obviously. You know, I'm at the right age. You know, I played the right instruments, I thought. And, of course, me with my big mouth, you know, before this audition, you could not get a straight answer out of anybody what this was. I had heard... We played instruments, and then I'd heard that it was only 10 people, and I heard and I'd heard so many things, and none of it made any sense to me. And I kept like trying to ask casting, look, I will audition so much better if just someone can give me a clear idea of what this is. I couldn't find enough information online about the production that had happened in the UK. It was just baffling to me. So I walked into my audition. I said, "Hello, Mr. Doyle. I know you're on a very tight schedule, but I really, if you could just take 2 minutes before I do anything for you and just explain to me what this is, because I don't know how to audition for you, because no offense, I like my Sweeney Todd big and loud with a full orchestra and a lot of people, so I don't know what we're doing here." And he of course was like, "Oh, well, come sit down, let's have a chat," you know, so we sat down at the table. And he told me the concept, and literally I was like, "No way." I was like, "No way, man." He was like, "No, it's been done. We've done it. We did it already. We did it in the UK. I was like, "I don't believe it, man. That's crazy." And we just had this great rapport, and he was like, "Do you have any conducting experience?" And I said, "Actually, yeah, I do. I have a lot of conducting experience." And he said, "How do you feel about playing a man?" And I'm like Rolodexing, and I'm like, "What? Like, which man?" You know, and he was like, "You know, what do you think about Pirelli?" He said, "Really, it's not playing Pirelli at all." He said, "It's like 6% Pirelli, but 94% doctor in charge." And I was like, "Well, what is my job, you know, if I'm the doctor in charge?" And he said, "Well, I need one person out of the 10 to be in charge, because nobody can leave the stage. You know, no one can, if anything, if instruments break, if bows break, if buckets, you know, of blood spill, if somebody has a problem, if chairs break, if, you know, I need one person to take action, because I can't have 10 people problem solving, you know, because the mm-hmm. show's got to go on. People got to keep playing. People have got to keep moving forward. So I need one person who can conduct and who can clean up messes and solve problems." And he said, "How do you feel about that?" And I said, I'm totally down for that. I'm good at that. You know, I used to be a teacher. I have no problem with that." And he said, "Well, how do you feel about that if you've got some high-powered personalities?" I said, "Look, as long as the high-powered personalities understand the rules of the game and understand that I'm in charge, I've got no problem telling anybody what to do, if that's my job. And everyone understands that's my job." And then that was it. And that's I auditioned for Pirelli, and he was like, "That's it." Isn't that weird?
And everybody was always
like, why is Pirelli a woman? And in the UK, it was merely because he worked with a theater company, and they ran out of guys. That's how it happened. But because they came over here, and he was already kind of open to that idea. Mm-hmm. You know, for him, he was just kind of looking for the right person for that role, not so much to play Pirelli. He really needed somebody that he could trust to, you know, handle things and still, you know, be a musician and be an actor. And so that's how that happened, which is crazy. And then, so I auditioned, and I thought, this is great, this is awesome. First day of rehearsal, we start with Greenfinch, which is flute heavy. It's a big, heavy piece for me. And about halfway through the day, we just worked on Greenfinch all day. That's all we did, all day, first day of rehearsal. About halfway through the day after lunch, he starts taking our stands away. He starts taking the music away. And I have always had, I've been able to sing and perform, you know, off book all my life, but I was a concert pianist. I was a pianist when I was younger, and I developed a phobia about not being able to play by memory in public. I was one of those young kids who set up phone books and played with orchestras, that one of those kids. And the pressure got to me. I'll never forget it. I was doing a Haydn concerto in D major. It was the second movement, and my mind went blank. I went to the white room, and the orchestra is there, and the audience is there, and I'm there, and I can't remember anything. And ever since then, I couldn't play anything on any instrument by memory. So I panicked.
Oh, no.
And on the next break, I went up to him, and I was like, John, I never got the memo that we were going to be off book, like, for this show. I said, this is a whole entire Sweeney Todd score. Like, I said, I can't do it, man. I literally, like, I have, like, a serious phobia. Like, I have a problem. I can't do it. I can't do it. And he was like, yes, you can. I was like, no. Seriously. I said, look, it's the first day of rehearsal. It's not too late to replace me. You got to fire me. You got to fire me right now or let me quit. And he was like, all right. He said, here's the thing. He said, every single person in this room is going to go through what you're going through right now. You just happen to be first. Blah, blah. Like, and I was like, dude, I'm not joking. You got to replace me. And he was like, all right. He said, give me 3 days. He said, and after 3 days, if you still want to quit, I will let you quit. He says, I'm telling you, within those 3 days, half of this cast is going to go through the same thing. And I was like, all right, man. You know. And it was amazing because the way he rehearsed, he would do, 15 seconds. And then he would add 2 more seconds. And then he would start at the top and go 17 seconds. And then he would add 3 more seconds, and then you would go 20 seconds all day long, just on one thing. So by the end of the day, you knew it.
Wow.
And I had never worked that way. I had never done that add 2 seconds, start at the top, add 3 seconds, start at the top. And by the third day, half of the cast had had a mental breakdown, just like I did. And we had already packed away a quarter of the show within 3 days. And another amazing thing that he did, because he knew I had a concern about people following my directions, you know, as the person in charge, in the rehearsal process, he would say to me, I want you to get Patti from that chair to that chair by that lyric, and he wouldn't tell Patti. So he also trained the other actors to follow my direction, no matter what it was. And they just got used to, if they saw me coming, they were like, oh, okay, she's going to tell me to go somewhere and I got to go. So by the time we got to the stage, you know, say, and this happened all the time, say, you know, a bow broke or say a chair broke and I had to fix that chair. I had to switch that chair out by the time the next scene came down, but the next scene wasn't 10 minutes from now. So I had 10 minutes. And anybody knew if I came up to them with eyeballs like this, they were like, okay, what am I moving? What am I switching out? What am I, you know? So he actually was brilliant. And then,
oh my goodness,
6 months into the run, my whole show was about Patti during rehearsal. My whole show was about taking care, not even Patti, Mrs. Lovett. My character made sure she was safe, made sure Sweeney never hurt her, made sure that she never hurt Toby. as far as the mental institution we were in, but my show revolved around Patti. I knew where Patti was every single second of that show. 6 months into the show, John comes up to me, and he goes, right. He says, you know how, you know, you're sort of taking care of Patti all night? And I said, yeah. And he said, well, now the most dangerous person on stage is Toby. And I went, I don't know where he is at the time. He was like, right, good luck. And he did that to everybody. He did that to everybody in the cast. He went up to everybody, gave them one note that completely changed their show. 6 months into the run, we all went out there like it was dress rehearsal. And it was the most amazing show that we had had because, you know, you do a show for 6 months. As alive as you try to keep it, you still get into, you get a new rhythm, you know what's coming, you get a little too relaxed. Even if you're not aware of it.
Mm-hmm.
And 6 months in, he came in and shook up that show by giving us all one piece of direction. He's brilliant.
That,
I know.
I'm just speechless of how awesome that is as a director.
Was like to sit on stage and just look around. I did plenty of sitting. I walked around more than anybody else because it was my job, but those moments where I could sit, you know, and play or whatever, and just look around, you know, it's so rare now that there isn't some sort of stunt casting, whether it's, you know, a celebrity who's, you know what I mean, or there's always a couple people on the cast at a certain level where you go, oh, I know why you're here, but, and to look around the stage and go, these are the best people for these roles on the planet. There's no stunt casting anybody. There's no trading anybody out here for somebody who has more Twitter followers. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
The nature of the show demanded that you get the not the most talented people, but the right people. You know what I mean? I mean, there's people out there who's far better pianists than I am, but my collection of talents made me the best person at that time for that role. That was one of the most wonderful things about doing that show, was the sort of boot camp mentality that mm-hmm. we went through in rehearsal. And then the camaraderie we had on stage. There was no actor left behind in Sweeney Todd, ever. Ever. It's one of the high points of my career for sure.
Yeah, and it's just in the show itself. I mean, that is not a walk in the park.
No.
That, I mean, just although.
Well, we ran for a year, and then it went on the road for a year, and they asked us all to go on the road, which is very nice. But like, I couldn't do it. I couldn't do it physically. The wear and tear of the accordion on me was very difficult, you know, because I was constantly trying to, it literally was, I wore it as a backpack a lot just to stretch during the show to give my shoulders a chance to go this way instead of this way. And also, it's just a very dark place to live. You know, I think we all were sort of getting slightly depressed, you know, doing the show because that's where you live for so much of your thing. So, I loved doing the show. I think a year-long run was perfect for me, and I was kind of happy that, like, you know, we were kind of done. Because I think we were already, like, just physically and emotionally, it was just like, you know, we were all, you know, we all had to peace out at that point. You know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I loved it. Loved it.
And just so many, just, there's such yeah. meat in that show that you get to chew on and to savor and to explore. And with you know, John Doyle as your director, who, so you're not going to approach this the set way or the quote-unquote normal way.
Like three times before, we'd all done Sweeney Todd, all of us. You know, I'd played Joanna, I'd, you know, been in the ensemble, I was in the pit. Like, I had done Sweeney Todd a lot already. And it was amazing to me, in rehearsal, people would say their lines, and I would be like, oh my God, I never, ever heard that line before. And I have done this show a gajillion times. Oh my God, I never made that connection between this and that. And the really cool thing, of course, was having Sondheim there. I remember he was working with Mark Jacoby on the Joanna, no, deliver me that, you know, where he's beating himself up. I was sitting there, because of course we were all the band, so we were at every rehearsal, so we were part of everybody's process, and we heard everybody's notes. Sondheim said to Mark, he said, now I know I've got this reputation for being finicky about, like, you know, my half note, you know, my eighth note rests or whatever. And he said, it's not as a musician. He said, it's as a writer. He said, you can do it or not. I don't care. He said, I'm just telling you, I gave you that eighth note rest there because it's a thought change. And he said, that's why I put it in there, because I felt like the judge needed a second to go like that. And I was just mind-blowing. This was the worst. So our first run through, and we sound like the worst squeeze box orchestra, like on crack. We sounded so bad. It was like the end of week two. We just sounded awful, and we were barely getting through it. Who walks in? Sondheim. To which all of us like crapped our pants and thought, well, great, this was fun, and we're all gonna get fired. So we get there, and we are all terrified, and we get through the entire show. It sounds, I mean, to us, it sounded like crap. And at the end of the run, John said to Steven, and he said to us, so do you have any notes? And we were all like, this is getting me bad. And the note that he said, honestly, you guys are too precious about my music. You know, he said, look, I don't care about wrong notes. He said, again, I know I have this reputation of being, you know, he said, I don't care about the notes. What I care about is the emotions behind the notes, the thought process behind the notes. And he said, you guys sounded so constipated today. And he said, and I know it's because you were trying to play every note correctly because I was in the room. And he said, if you ever have to decide when doing my stuff, to decide between doing it note perfectly or emotionally and mentally perfectly, always choose the latter. He said, that's what I want. He says, I write not because I want you to do it perfectly because I'm an egomaniac. He says, I write because I feel like that's the best way to write for this character who has to take this emotional journey. You know, and I was like, wow, that just blew my mind. And from that day on, we played immensely better because we weren't worried about every note. And of course, as a result, we were less constipated. And then, like, you know,
then it's just becomes internalized.
Because we were concentrating more on what is this moment? What are we trying to create atmospherically? What's my job right now with this, you know, cello line that I'm playing on the accordion? What's my job here? And then all of a sudden it came together and we sounded great. It was amazing. I know, that whole experience was like, I could write an entire book. It was bananas.
Mr. Sondheim, he does not write, he writes shows that are challenging in a good way. If that makes sense. I directed Into the Woods, and that was a challenge in itself. And 2 days after, I had my appendix out. Mr. Samuel.
But here's the great thing that is very similar between I think Steve and John Doyle, is that they both come up from a place of doing the piece. They don't have an eye out for, you know, is this going to be commercially successful? Is this going to do box office? They both come from a very pure place of, this is the piece, this is the art, this is what we're doing. If people dig it and buy tickets, fantastic. If they don't, you know, I mean, look at Sondheim. time. He was clearly 30 years ahead of his time. You know, when the first production of Sweeney Todd was on Broadway, it was a horrible flop. People were walking out. The cannibalism, people weren't ready for it. You know, and now look at it. It was a movie with Johnny Depp, for Christ's sake. You know what I mean? Like, it's just, you know. it's amazing.
And
so, yeah, it was really cool to work with both of them on it because they both come from a very pure place of we're not doing this for the bucks. That's not our job. That's other people's job to worry about that. And it created a really great, safe, fun rehearsal space.
Yeah, I think that just offers so much to actors. And you kind of have to be ready for everything, but when you get those moments that you're really able to explore, and then you have to savor them, and that's
really
sometimes it's those places that you can go back to, too, when you're having a hard time, you can go, okay, but...
I did that once. Yeah, I do that a lot, believe me. And I'm actually personally just sort of grateful that that didn't happen to me until I was, in my early 30s. I don't think if it had happened to me when I had just graduated from college or something, I don't think I would have nearly appreciated what it was.
Yeah.
So I'm actually really great. And even just this whole thing with me, like, you know, I'm a 45-year-old woman who's a series regular on television. Like, that's, first of all, people always told me as a woman, if you haven't hit television by, like, 29, you're out. Which I, believed. I thought, well, that makes sense. Not like I care, because I love the theater, and I'm fine. And, I'm so, so happy that this TV thing happened for me when I'm in my mid-40s. You know, I feel like it's the right time. And if it had happened earlier, it wouldn't have been right. I wouldn't have appreciated it enough I wouldn't have been able to do the other things that I have so loved doing that prepared me for this, So that's another big lesson I find myself, that everything has its time, everything has its place. You know, I mean, the college grads are now coming to New York and doing their leaks presentations, and, they're in that place of, I got to get an agent, and I got to be a star, and I got to, and I just want to just go, it's okay.
Mm-hmm. And
it's okay.
And I think so much in our pop culture-wise, there is that... There's that focus towards fame or whatever you want to call it. And great, but fame's there, but is fame going to satisfy your soul?
It's icing on cake, you can only eat so much of it and then you get sick, But also what's really great, though, that I'm actually really jealous of is that, college graduates now, they have the internet. I mean, again, I'm only 29, but when I graduated college, we didn't even have cell phones, dude. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, so I just think, oh, my God, what would I have done, if I had had YouTube when I was, 22? I'd like to think that, I would have been proactive. I might have been intimidated, maybe, quite honestly. But, look at Rachel Bloom.
Yeah, I mean, I think she's the positive example of... Using it as an outlet to do your passion, and I think it worked out for her. Everyone and you.
I think it worked out for her because she didn't put stuff on YouTube to get a bunch of hits.
Mm-hmm.
She put stuff on YouTube that she wanted to create because it came from an authentic place of this is my voice, this is what I think, this is what I think is funny, and that's why it caught the attention of Aline.
Yeah.
She didn't do salacious stuff just for the, or stuff to just, get a million hits because it was, whatever. She only put work up that she was invested in as an artist.
Mm-hmm.
And I think people are attracted to Rachel's authenticity. I mean, obviously, she's amazingly talented. She's a genius. But I think what really separates her a lot of the other people out there, especially on YouTube, is her authenticity, which mm-hmm. I'm a huge fan of.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to next season because I know you all are going to delve much deeper, and I'm excited, and I'm also going to go, oh my goodness, they went there. every now and then, because I downloaded the album, or an album, whatever.
Half of the first season, yeah.
Yeah, and you know, there's the TV version, and then there's the... I was like, oh my... Not that it fit me, but I was like, oh my goodness.
Here's the thing, though. We were supposed to originally be on Showtime.
Yeah.
So, you know, she's coming from a place of that. But also, think about this, though. Rachel is not only our female lead, she's also one of the head writers, she's an executive producer, and she's composing. Now, first of all, there aren't enough hours in the day just to do two of those things, mm-hmm. let alone four. She is so dedicated, though, to, like, the authenticness of what those songs really were in her mind. She will take the extra time to do, not only record those explicit versions, but shoot them. Do you know what I mean? Like, that's the thing about Rachel that is uncommon, is she will go that extra mile, and she will pay the extra money, and she will take the extra time to offer people...
Okay, well, now I can't wait till the DVD Blu-ray release to see all the...
I don't know,
but it's my hope.
Dude, the outtakes on our show are...
I can only...
The blooper reels are insane. We had a wrap party, and our post editing staff put together just like a 20-minute blooper reel, which was a fraction of the crazy stuff that we've done just for fun. It's highly entertaining. It's a really great group because we all have improv backgrounds. And also, the tone on the set is incredibly safe. It's a very, very happy, safe set. And everyone's opinions are welcome. And, you know, there's a lot of, sure, let's try that, you know, which is not common. I'm told. Again, I don't have much to compare it to except for, like, you know, a day here, a day there on other shows, like, you know, The Good Wife and Younger or whatever, mm-hmm. but... Our set apparently is uncommonly theater-like, where it's, you know, the barn is free, let's do a show. It's very much that mm-hmm. energy all day long, which I guess is rare. But I think that's one of the reasons why the work is so sort of alive and, mm-hmm. and bubbly. You know, there's nobody, like, yelling at you or, you know.
Or someone closed off and leave me alone,
you know,
and don't talk to me on stage.
We do a couple takes. Each direction, legit, like, word for word. I mean, which, the writing's amazing. So there's really no, you know, there's no point to change anything. It's all great. And then we do a loosened run. And then if we have time, we do what's called a fun run. And that's when we just go off the rails. As long as we as characters hit our plot points that we have to hit in the scene. You know, like, as Paula, I have to make sure that I get out, you know, like, you know, the photos and the this and the timeline. Those are my things. You know, we just go completely bananas.
Which is going to be fun.
Use it, you know. Sometimes they use it. Like, they just used one of mine the other day. It was, you know, I think my line was, like, you know, I pray to God all the time, and I wondered if he was ever listening, blah, blah, blah. And then we did it a fun run, and I just changed it to she, because I thought it was funny. And then we used it. And I never thought in years they would use it. Big laugh.
Oh, that makes it such an exciting and great place to work, because I think that's, if you get to have that, you have that structure, but also that fun, you know.
Yeah.
You gotta love going to work every day. Even if it is, you know, you gotta hit all these 20 things and get it done by this time because you had to get the episode done.
Yeah, and honestly, the audition for Crazy Ex-Girlfriend was exactly the same. I had 3 auditions total. After each audition, I called my agent and was like, they'll never hire me, but I had the best time. You know, every audition, I would call him and say the same thing. I'd be like, I will never book this job because I don't book television. But they are the nicest people, and I can't wait to watch the show. And then they hired me. I couldn't believe it.
Oh,
I was so happy.
Yeah, that is, it's great when all those things work out together. And I think to be, as we were saying, we're the same age, is I think what I'm discovering now is, you know, okay, you can't be anyone else. You got to be you. So just be you and go after your passions. And
that's another lesson to any young actors out there. You know, it's such a time waster to try and go in a room and be like the next Kristen Chenoweth because you think they want a Kristen Chenoweth type, or you know what I mean? I tried so hard to be what I thought they wanted me to be in the room, which, first of all, most of the time they don't know what they want. They're waiting for it to come into the room. And literally the day that I was like, okay, it's too exhausting to try and figure out what they want and then be that. And it's just so exhausting. The day that I was like, I'm just going to go in there and be myself and do what I would do with it. That's when I started to book. And I never knew what my type was either, you know? And once I started to do that, a friend of mine literally was like, I just took a class with Bernard Telsey Casting, and they literally said, so what type are you? Are you a Sutton Foster type? Are you a Donna Lynne Champlin type? Are you a, and I was like, oh, wait. Wait a minute. So I never knew what my type was because it hadn't been invented yet. And I was like, will you please tell them to call me and tell me what that type is? Because I don't even know what a Donna Lynne Champlin type is. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So, like, you know, for any young actors out there, stop trying to figure out what type you are and just, like, be yourself and create a new type.
Mm-hmm.
You know? But that took me a lot. I wasted a lot of years figuring that out. So that's a time saver for all of you.
It's
a waste of time to try and be anything you're not.
I wanted to touch on one or two other things. So we have theater teachers who listen to this, and also and the directing in. What things, because I know that's part of your resume too, what things come to mind that you might want to share with them to help them with their process?
Well, I mean, gosh, you know, when you're a director, I mean, it's kind of like being an actor because your moving parts are so different. You know, a director who's working on Broadway is, you know, clearly has like the cream of the crop of, you know, on all levels. So, I mean, that director's job is more of like a bonsire, I think, you know. You know, you hire the best people because you can get the best people. You put them all in a room. You know, and you snip here and there, but basically you just let those people do what they do. But, you know, I mean, if you're a director of, like, you know, a high school musical or, like, a, you know what I mean, or a community theater, your problems are different. You know, and, in, you know, at one level, the best you can do as a director is get out of an actor's way. On another level, you know, the best thing you can do for that actor is, you know, strip them down or, you know, I don't know. I think the best advice I could give for a director is every show is different. Do you know what I mean? And every group of people is different. And it's better to be adaptable as a director to the situation that you're in with the people that you have. Than to be like, you know, this is the way I do it.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I just think I had a director like that once, you know, who finally, I mean, it was just problematic. You know, he was a line reader. He would give you line readings. And, you know, here's the thing. In the theater, that's a no-no because you have plenty of time to figure it out. On TV, though, like, a lot of times, like, a director will be like, I want you to do it. I was like, give me a line reading. Because we just don't have time. I won't be offended, you know? But he was, like, constantly, he was giving everyone a line reading to the point where everyone's line had been fed to them, and then the whole show was constipated. You know what I mean? Because mm-hmm. no one felt any freedom. I finally took him out for a drink, you know, and I said, okay, listen, man, here's the thing. I like you as a person, you know, but the room is bad, and you're tightening the room, and no one feels free to kind of, it's a comedy, you know, like, if you could maybe just loosen up a little bit, just let us kind of breathe a little bit, you know, we might. And he was like, well, you know, I was the mentee of a very famous director, and that's how he did it, and so that's how I do it. And I, you know, I felt bad. I was like, oh, sir, you are no very famous director. And I said, honey, I'm trying to save you from a coup. I'm trying to save you from a revolt that's about 36 hours away. But if you're going to stick to your guns and just be like, this is how I do it, then I'm going to back up, you know? So I think the best director for me is the one that constantly bobs and weaves depending on, well, that actor needs more specifics. That actor is fine. That actor needs to be bonsai'd and that's all they need. You know, this actor needs blah, 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 blah. I would say stay malleable. And the more directing techniques that you have, and also the best directors for me have been former actors. Mm-hmm. Because they understand what the job is. Mm-hmm. And just as actors, again, young actors, if you don't go to college and whatever, part of my training at CMU was to be on props crew, on electrics, on costume crew. It was wonderful because I understand what everybody's job is, and I understand the constraints of everybody's job, and I understand I can only ask for something within a certain window. So I would say to directors, I would do some acting work. and then it's much easier to know, like, what the job is and how you can help us, and how you can help us by not helping us sometimes. I would say, you know, yeah, for me, that's the best kind of director. I prefer directors who less is more, just because I'm a people pleaser. So if you give me like 8 pieces of direction on like one scene, I'm not going to be able to focus on the scene. I'm going to be focusing on all your direction. But if you give me like 1, maybe 2 solid center bullseye pieces of direction for the scene, I'll be able to give you what you need, you know? Mm-hmm. But yeah, I'd say do some acting yourself and stay malleable. Those would be my suggestions as a director, having directed myself.
So, I know you've got some really cool things coming up, and which I was so thrilled, one, that you were able to announce them, so we could talk about them.
Well, it's so funny, you know, I've been sitting on these gigs for weeks, and then they both decided to announce on the same day. It was like a social media explosion for me. It was not planned at all. They're totally different camps. They just decided to announce on the same day.
One thing you were doing, we were going to try to do a test recording on Thursday. Who were you working with on Thursday and Friday?
I was working with Mr. Matt Damon and Miss Kristen Wiig and Mr. Alexander Payne on a new movie that they're filming called Downsizing.
I really like it.
I'm legally not allowed to say anything about the actual movie. I can say that the experience of shooting it was awesome. They couldn't have been nicer. Actually, Kristen Wiig and I are from the same hometown. We're both from Rochester. So we had tons to chit-chat about. And then Matt Damon's mom is a teacher. My mom is a teacher. We both have small children. We talked a lot about, you know, private school versus public school and education and blah, blah, blah. And they just could not have been nicer. And they were at the end of their first week of shooting. And, you know, that's, the first week is really hard because it's like going to the gym, you know, it's, you got to build up those muscles for the long days. And, you know, we were the last shot of the last day, and they must have been exhausted. And they could not have been kinder to me. And it was not an easy scene for me. I had a lot of words to say. That's all I can say about it. And they really could not have been more supportive. And they were lovely.
And I think Alexander Payne, which I first discovered him with Election.
Oh, I love that movie.
Yeah, which is, I mean, just the whole being a teacher,
The classroom.
And I met the, because it was filmed in, I think, Omaha, and I go up for the Thespian Festival a lot, which is in Lincoln, Nebraska, and know the teacher who was there, or where the school that was filmed, and just all those.
He's incredibly cool. He actually has a big, for me, has a theater vibe. Which is maybe one of the reasons why we kind of clicked, you know? We kind of have the same, I don't know, we just have the same, he's got a theater vibe. Like, I had my audition. I auditioned for a completely different role that I was not right for at all. I honestly was just going in to just meet the casting director and be like, hey, I'm out here doing a TV show. You know, if something comes up that I'm actually right for, give me a call. And he actually showed the tape to Alexander Payne, who was like, oh my God, she's so wrong for that part, but I really like her. Is there another role that she, you know, could come in for? And so there was, and so I came in, and he was there, to which I was like, oh, hi. And then after I read, he was like, yeah, he said, so anyway, listen, I really, you know, he said, I've got to see other people for this part, so, but I really would like you to be in the movie, you know, are you up for, like, being so-and-so's wife, or, you know, does it matter to you, like, how big the part is? I was like, no. So then he says to me, he says, can I have your cell number? And I thought, that's weird, because, of course, like, mostly in my mind, I'm thinking, he is never going to call me. Like, this is Hollywood. These are the things they say. It's, you know, but for a moment in time, Alexander Payne wanted me in his movie. You know what I mean? Like, I'm thinking, this is never going to happen. So then he says, can I have your cell number? And I was like, that's taking it a little far. but I thought, well, sure. So I gave him my cell number. I thought, that was weird. And while I was here in New York for a callback for Taming of the Shrew, I got this phone call from, like, Canada. And I thought, well, I'm not picking that up. It's Canada. And it was him. He called me personally on a Saturday to say, hey, you know, we finally got casting straight, and we want you for this role, and, you know, we're so excited, and blah, blah, blah. I was like, what is happening? But, like, that's like a theater dude move, mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That's a guy who, like, likes to interact and is, like, totally down to earth. And I mean, it was amazing. He called me on my cell phone, and he was like, oh, by the way, you know, like, here's my cell phone. And like, my favorite part was, like, it's Alexander Payne. I don't know if you remember me, but you auditioned for me a couple weeks ago. I literally was like, what? I'm not going to remember you. Like, what is happening right now? And of course, on set, he was just, I mean, you know, he was just very, very kind and very, he actually reminded me a lot of Bart Shearer, quite honestly. He's got a Bart Shearer kind of vibe to him. You know, funny, dry, but, you know, very, very easy. Specific, very specific.
And but I think if you're specific, his work's very, very nuanced and very, it's very, I guess specific is a word, but it's, then, which as an actor gives you, I mean, you know where you're headed, so then you have some freedom and creativity with that, because sometimes, if it's too open, then you're like, oh, I'm all over the place, because you don't know what.
On Crazy Ex-Girlfriend, you know, we have a different director almost every episode, and, I mean, now, we started to repeat some directors to the second half of the season, but it was almost like, you know, the directors are coming in and they don't really know the show almost as well as you know the show. So for me, that was an adjustment too, coming from the theater where they'd come up to me and be like, what do you think? And I'd be like, I don't know. I don't know. I said, you know, I'll do it like 5 different ways for you. You can pick your favorite, but I can't help you. So yeah, I mean, it is nice to sort of have those parameters because then, you know, you can bounce in between, but you know how far you can go. He was very much like that, Mr. Payne.
And then your next gig, which I can't wait, and I just started showing my students, I show the 1976 ACT version of it, which I think is so
ACT
much...
ACT version?
Yes.
The, oh, okay. You were going to tell me you were going to do the...
Elizabeth Taylor? No.
Yeah.
No, I love the Commedia part of it. I love the... Saw it in college and been teaching with that one ever since.
I know it better through Kiss Me, Kate. I mean, mm-hmm. I studied Shakespeare and Chekhov at Oxford for a semester. So, I know the plot of Kiss Me, Kate before I auditioned. Anyway, Taming of the Shrew. And I was trying like, okay, so that number is I hate men, right? Okay.
Yeah. Or I watch it and because I directed Kiss Me, Kate. I know 10-12 years ago.
Yeah.
And, you know, or the May It Do Him Ease, or whatever the song is at the end of the show. And,
yeah. Well, the cool thing about this production, though, is it's all women. Because, you know, Taming the Shrew is tough. It, depending on how you do it, it can come off really misogynistic. So it's tricky. You know, the whole ending part, you know, why does she turn around? What is it about, you know, does he tame her or does she tame herself? You know what I mean? It's very, very tricky mm-hmm. to pull that off and not have it be very chauvinistic. And I think one of the reasons, you know, having all women play all the roles is really going to help us delve even more into that sort of chauvinistic, misogynistic subject matter mm-hmm. from a completely different, you know, and we all play instruments, too. It's another one of those. So we'll be playing instruments. Me, Lena Wright out, and Nathan. It's the Hillbilly Mafia, is basically is what it is. It's, you know, those of us gals in town who play the instruments. I'm very excited. We actually start rehearsal tomorrow. So
I'm super excited.
I don't know much about it beyond that. You know, and I think Felicia, our director, I think obviously she has a game plan, but I think she's also, you know, one of those directors, again, who stays very malleable and is going to put us all in a room and see how we all work, you mm-hmm. know, like how we all work together as a group. And, you know, she's already sent us an email saying it's very ensemble, very all the time, you know, even if it's not your part, you know, be prepared to be present. Either musically or, you know, so usually rehearsal periods like that is just 10 to 6 every day for everybody, which I kind of love.
that's going to be cool and exciting, and I think it's got a great cast. Yeah. Janet McTeer is Petruchio.
Yeah, and Judy Gold is in there. She's Gremio, I think. We got some funny ladies.
Yeah, and Kush Jumbo from Good Wife is Catherine, and...
Yes, and oh, I can't remember her name. I'm a huge fan of hers from Origin is the New Black. I don't know, now it's going to bother me. But she did this brilliant monologue. Do you watch Origin is the New Black?
Yes.
She's the one that did that brilliant monologue about joining Judaism. And she has that moment where, you know, she's like, I found my people, I found my tribe. And it was one of those where I was like, wait a minute. And I rewound it and watched it like 10 times to just be like, that's some of the most spectacular acting I have ever seen. You should, I can't remember her name, but I'm a huge fan, so I can't wait.
It should be exciting and I think fun, and just, I can't wait to see what comes out of it. I think.
I did the park a few years ago. I did actually like it. I played opposite Oliver Platt as Touchstone, and that was a blast. But my kid was like not even a year old, so I was always exhausted, and you know, I literally can't remember most of it. Because I was so tired.
Yeah.
So I'm excited to go back now and, like, be fully rested. Yeah. And enjoy it as the parent of a 4.5-year-old, which is
yes. Yeah, when they sleep through the night, it's a parent. It does make that a little bit easier.
Oh my lord! It's just a
yeah.
Fever
that first
dream.
Year.
If I look back on it, it was a fever dream. I can't remember anything. I was so tired. I think he was like 8 months old.
Well, I've had such a great time chatting with you.
Yeah, this is great. Awesome.
We have a little fun little question we ask our guests at the end, and I think for you, I think so apropos to the character you play on My Crazy Ex-Girlfriend. So what technical ability that Paula has do you want to have or could use, or using Paula's thing, what would you do to what world problem or?
Oh, world problem?
Well, not world problem, but what would you want to find out that Paula could totally get into?
we've established on the show that she's, like, beyond technically savvy. Like, she's a super hacker. And, I mean, as you and I have experienced, just trying to figure out technically how to get my computer to do Skype, I would love to have those super savvy computer hacker skills. I would use them for good, though. I would use those powers for good. I would hook up with, like, you know, Anonymous or something and be like, you know, she just kind of uses it for her own personal game. I think she's got big talents that she uses for small jobs or small-minded jobs. But yeah, oh man, I am so envious of Paula's tech savvy, for sure. I could definitely use a little bit of that.
And if people want to find you on Twitter, how do they do that?
I am at DL Champlin, Champlin. And then Instagram, which I'm just starting to be active on. It's Donna, and then not the dash, but like the underline space thing, you know? So it's Donna,
underscore,
Lynn, underline space, Champlin. On Instagram. And then I have a website. It is woefully out of date. I am working on it. I'm going to get somebody to help me update it. But that is www.donnalynnechamplin.com. So that's pretty much it.
Well, thank you so much for joining us. And if people want to follow me, I'm at Tech4Theater. And of course, catch this on TheatreCast.org. And so I want to thank you again for taking time, and
thanks
so happy that we're able to join together and get this recorded. And so thank you, and we'll catch you all in the next TheatreCast.
Bye!